I said I wasn't going to paint anything, I wasn't going to sandblast anything, and yet, here we are, sandblasted and painted. So you need parts for your Chevy, Ford, or Mopar? Well, guess what? The guys at National Parts Depot have those parts in stock right now. If you need a part for your classic car, they probably have it. They have four convenient locations across the United States. They have a location in Ocala, Florida, one in Charlotte, North Carolina, another in Detroit, Michigan, and one in Ventura, California. You can call these guys 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, nearly 365 days a year, and get the parts you need for your classic car. What's not to like? If you don't want to talk to a human being, they have a website available that has all the parts listed on there, and you can order them right online from anywhere in the world. Give National Parts a try. We like these guys. They've worked with us for a long, long time. Great people, great service, and you can get the parts really quick. Definitely a lot easier with help, but somebody's got to run camera. Might as well be Logan. All right, so what I've got here is my painted spindle. Now, the reason I painted the spindle is I actually didn't paint the spindle. What I was attempting to do here was to take my sandblaster and sandblast all these surfaces to make sure everything was good to go. The spindles were pretty greasy, so I wanted to also do a check on them and make sure they were okay. And everything looks pretty good. We've got a couple of places over on the backside here where they're scarred up a little bit, but I don't think that's going to hurt our mounting surfaces for our caliper at all. You may be wondering why I have a brake fluid bottle on this spindle assembly. That's simply to keep from doing any kind of sand impacts on my bearing ride surfaces inside of the bottle. I don't mind if loose sand is in there because it is just a ride surface. There's no bearings in there. So I put that on here to keep from causing a problem on the bearings themselves. That was the only reason I did that. Why didn't I go in and do the entire arm assembly, pull everything apart, and do all that kind of stuff? Simply put, as I've said before, this is a driver truck. I am not that concerned about the rest of it. But with this being bare and not having any paint on it at all, it would rust in no time after having been sandblasted. So I put some paint on there just as a preservative for no other reason than that. And I used Duplicolor caliper paint because I had it here. No other reason than that. May I go in and possibly, you know, before we put it in the truck, black these out and make them look nice? Maybe. So anyway, I'm going to pull this stuff out. We're going to go in and start talking about our rotors and getting all that set up so that we can put them on the spindles and get all that rocking and rolling the way it needs to be. I'm kidding, it's not that heavy, but it's pretty heavy. All right, now that we got the spindles and all in, I wanted to talk about a little bit of housekeeping stuff. What if you get the kit, what should you do? First thing I would do before I did anything else is I would go in and check the rotors to make sure if they are within spec or not. If they are outside of spec, most rotors are marked around the inside diameter as to what the minimum is. These are actually within safe tolerances. We could possibly get them turned and reuse them. But I don't feel real comfortable with that because I don't know how much I'm going to need to turn out in order to get rid of all this rust pitting that's all the way around this rotor. We may go out of spec trying to get that to come in. Same thing with your calipers. These calipers might would be able to be reused. You can go in and get a rebuild kit for them, or you can get them new from National Parts Depot, like I'm going to show you in just a second. But the price on them with the core return is so cheap, you can't rebuild them. It's like rotisserie chicken at Walmart. It's actually cheaper to buy the rotisserie chicken than it is to make the chicken yourself. Bottom line. So I would say probably on these, just take them off, pull all the parts off of them that you need, and send the calipers in to National Parts Depot so that you can get the new calipers because, yeah, it's the best way to go. One last little thing on housekeeping. If you're going to do this, the proportioning valve is available, and I highly recommend getting the proportioning valve from National Parts. But this bracket right here is something that you are going to want or need. And rather than having to make it yourself out of box tube or something like that, you can get the one off of the truck, do it, because it's going to make a big difference in mounting all this stuff up. Some of this is already here on a standard drum brake truck, but I don't think the bracket is the same. I'm pretty sure it's completely different. A lot of guys will tell you, just buy a truck, get all the stuff all you want off of it, and sell the rest of it off for scrap. I can't find them cheap enough to make that sensible to me, so that when I'm at the junkyard, what I'm going to try to do is grab everything I can grab. I would go ahead and grab the proportioning valve. If you want to do it, you can also take the brake lines off of the truck that you're getting all the parts off of, and then you got everything you possibly could want. So that's that. I'm going to pull all this stuff off the table. We're going to start talking about parts. All right, now what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna grease this bearing up, and I like to use a bearing greasing tool. Typically when I'm doing anything on these with the wheel bearings and all, I will use Mobil 1 grease on it. I like synthetics for this kind of stuff. The heat properties on it are a lot better. All right, this should be that one. Then I'll set it aside. Try to take this apart with the grease on my hands. Now you can see there's plenty of grease here and plenty of grease on the bearing inside of here. What this does is it pushes the grease into the bearing from the inside out. So you'll get plenty of grease on the race on the inside and on the outside of the bearing. What I typically will do is I'll pick up this, take this off of here, and you can see what I got going on. See how much there is inside of here, and then I'll take this and I'll work the outside of it and just get it greased up. I'm going to now put my inner bearing in and my rear seal on here. So the bearing sits in like that, yuck, and then the rear seal sits in. All right, now we got the bearing and the oil seal in, so what I'm going to do is pull this to the side and get the spindle up here on the tabletop so we can start doing the assembly of the rotor onto the spindle. Now what I will say is you don't really want to mess with cleaning this up until you've got the rotor completely mounted on the spindle before you put the calipers on, because it's just a pain to do it sitting here on the floor. You can spin it on the bearings, make it a little easier on yourself cleaning it up. But I'll set this aside. Oh my God, it's heavy. All right, now I'm going to put the rotor on here. Now, I'm not going to obviously final install any of this stuff. I'm just going to show you how to set this up. Oops, got stuck. Okay. Get that tightened down a little bit. I've got a torque wrench. I'm going to set it to 22. Now I'm gonna go to 22 foot-pounds of torque on the nut, and then I'm going to back it off from there, and that's the recommendation from Ford on this. This is a 1 1/16. What they're trying to do is to get this thing to seat. Okay, that's now seated. Now I'm going to loosen it. you're supposed to loosen it until it's basically hand tight. You're looking for inch pounds. So you could basically take and tighten it. What they say is to tighten it up with your fingers. Now, if you got baby fingers, that might not be a good thing. Maybe you want to go down and get yourself a inch pound torque wrench in order to check that out. But I mean, I just normally will do that. I'll go to the 25 foot pounds and I'll back everything off and then retighten it by hand and then try to see if we're good for the castellated nut. And I might be able to get it to work right there. Nope. So we're gonna have to see if we can finger tighten it a little bit more. There you go. And again, I'm not gonna fully pull this over, but what they recommend from Ford is that you take your cotter pin and pull the cotter pin, both legs of it, over the top of your spindle right here. Then obviously you'll cap it up and you'll be done with that. All right, so that's how you torque down the rotor on your F100. I'm gonna go in now and talk about mounting calipers and cleaning everything up. All right, I got some acetone. You can use acetone to clean the brake rotors. I'm gonna put a little rag underneath it. This will get all that cosmoline that they put on them at the factory off. And you wanna make sure that the surfaces of your rotors are free of any oils. You'll note that I'm wearing gloves. That's for the same reason. You don't wanna get your skin oils on your rotors because that could make a hot spot when you're braking later. So you wanna make sure that you rub them down real nice with the acetone to get everything cleaned off. But you can look and see the amount of dirt I'm pulling off of there with my cloth. I'll usually try to also do the outside perimeter as well a little bit, just simply to make sure that I don't have any grease that's gonna seep down onto these rotors, because these things get really warm when you're braking. So you'll just wanna run this through here, and you'll also wanna get the back side of your rotor. How dirty can they get? Pretty darn dirty. All right, I think we're probably pretty good now on that. I'm gonna give it another wipe and I'll use my air gun to blow it off a little bit. But again, sometimes your air gun can cause problems too, because you may have oil in the line on your air gun. I will go in and spray this portion of the rotor just so that it's a nice metal color like the silver from this, or a cast coat. Just to keep it from rusting anymore while it's on the vehicle. If they have a cast coat caliper paint, then you can use that on these and that'll look just like it should look. So now I'm going to mount the calipers up and show you how that works. All right, now we're going to go ahead and put the caliper on here so you can see how this works. Now what I'm going to do is install the anti-rattle clip. Now this clip, you can see the configuration it has, actually goes like right here on the bottom of the pad, and I always put it on the wrong side. I don't know why. All right, so it goes on the bottom of the pad, on the inner pad this way, and getting them all to go in here and talk nicely to each other sometimes can be a real pain. And what that's to do is to keep that pad stable in the mounting position, because if you don't put the anti-rattle in there, sometimes under braking, you'll get a chatter out of the pads if that's missing. Now, the next thing we're gonna do is we're gonna mount our caliper. And we're going to put our pad inside the caliper and then put it on here. Now you can see why I wear gloves doing this, because if I don't have gloves on, I'm going to put oils on the mounting surface or the braking surface, and that's not going to be good. Now that just sits like that for now. And then we have to put our spring and our retainer. This will go like this and be driven onto here. Okay, you set that in like this. You use a hammer. I use a leather hammer to install the bracket. Now you'll note that there is no screw here. That's because of all the things I got off that other truck, which I got the tie rods, I got the brake proportioning valve, I got the calipers, I got the rotors, everything else was there. The only thing that was actually missing were these screws, and I am trying to locate a pair of these even as we speak. So as soon as I can find a pair of those, that will finalize that. Now the last thing I'm going to talk about is mounting up your brake hose on the back here. I'm going to go ahead and show you that so that you can get an idea of how that looks and works on the F100. All right, I'm going to move this back around and I'm just going to put the hose on here. The thing I'm finding with this setup, the way we're doing it right now, is there are copper washers everywhere. These copper washers that came with the caliper itself are nice and thick. I like these. These are the ones we're going to go with. So when you're ordering this stuff from National Parts Depot, don't order the copper washers if you're getting calipers, because the hoses come with copper washers, the caliper comes with copper washers. So in my opinion, if you're getting either one of those, don't worry about the copper washers. Now this is your brake hose. And there's a side specific setup on these. You have right and left. So you have your brake hose, you have a copper washer on your banjo bolt, they put it through, then the other copper washer on the other side, and you feed that down in there. And then you need to gorilla up on it. You want to make sure when you put everything in for final, though, that you don't have any leaks around either one of the copper washers. If you do, you're just going to have experience. You're going to experience all kinds of problems with squishy brake pedals and all that. All right, that's basically how all this stuff goes together. Now, we're not going to be going and putting this stuff on the truck today because we have other fish to fry that are going to be involved with the installation of the disc brake assembly and the I-beams and the radius arms on the truck. We've got a couple videos we're going to be doing with that. So we will be putting the whole assembly on at some point, and I wanted to get everything mounted on here because in some respects, it'll be just easier to go ahead and do it this way than it would be to try to put all this stuff on after we get everything in the truck. You can cut that bread either way you want to do it. The biggest problem we have right now is I just don't have any help yet. Until we get out of this quarantine situation, I've got Logan and Logan that can push cars around with me and move things. We need to get the wagon off the lift so that we can get the truck on the lift so that we can shoot this stuff, because it's just a lot easier to do what we're going to be doing with sway bar installations and I-beam stuff with it on a lift. Just believe that, and that's what's going to happen. So all of this right here is going to stay the way it is, and we'll put it all on the truck later. We're going to get the parts that we didn't order correctly from National Parts Depot. And then, boom, in the next couple of weeks, you'll see the I-beams go in. You'll see the sway bars going on. So you'll have a lot of stuff going on in the next couple of weeks on this F100. And next week, I'm going to be talking a little bit about why we're doing what we're doing and why we're not going with a Crown Vic front end. We've touched lightly on that some, but we've had a couple more guys write in and ask the questions. I'm getting these gloves off. Ask the questions about that. So that's that. Well, that's what we have for the show for this week, folks. Do us a favor, put a comment in the section below. Let us know what you're thinking about what we're doing here. Also, give us a thumbs up or a thumbs down. I prefer these, but if you want to do one of these, that's fine too. Subscribe to the channel if you're not already subscribed. Our goal is by December of 2020 to have 100,000 subscribers. Don't know if we'll make it, but we're sure as heck going to try, and we can't do that without you supporting the channel. So come back and watch us next time on Auto Restomod. You guys have a great week. We'll see you later.